Do you draw?
No, I guess that's part of the reason I'm into this stuff is like I'm pretty bad at, making the art myself. It's basically saying compute go up, language model go burr.
Welcome back to the Inside View podcast, a show where I ask beginner level questions to experts about the future of AI progress. This is one of my favorite episodes of the podcast so far. I talk about AI art with Charlie Snell. He's an undergrad at Berkeley who does research in NLP, in RL with Sergey Levine, and happens to run a blog about deep learning for the ML at Berkeley Association. Most importantly, Charlie has written a bunch of very good blogs on AI art called AI Alien Dreams and a series of blogs about DALL-E. It was such a blast to ask newbie questions to someone who understands all of the deep learning techniques such as Charlie. It was very smart, very clear in his explanations. It's, for me, rare to find a combination of traits. And I'm very lucky to have found someone as Charlie to explain AI art to me for like 3 hours. On top of that, I think we look at a bunch of different art, which is much more enjoyable for like a YouTube video. And so like for the first part of the conversation, we talk about DALL-E. So it's like a research done by OpenAI back in January. It was trained end-to-end to generate images from prompts. We talk about Clip plus VQGAN. So Clip is another model by OpenAI who does also matching of prompts on images. And VQGAN is a state-of-the-art GAN who is very popular in the art scene. At the end of the video, we look at different pieces of art made using Clip, including tricks from using VQGAN plus Clip, videos, or even clip guided diffusion, which is like one of the latest research done by OpenAI. I hope you enjoy our conversations as much as I did. And for my personal taste, I think this video is a tiny bit long and we go over a lot of things. So I would just like advise you to either choose a specific topic you'd like or, go through it at 2x the speed. And without further ado, here's my chat with Charlie
Snell that I never met in real life.
Yeah, only this is spoken in over Twitter.
I was super interested in your blog, Alien Dreams, that you posted. Do you want to summarize shortly how did you end up writing this piece?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. So these clip art thing has been just started like around January. In general, I'm like fairly. I guess the word might be addicted, but like I'm very on Twitter, and I ended up seeing like around January, right after Clip released, people were basically posting these images that they were able to generate with Clip, which was sort of surprising because it wasn't really designed to generate images. And so I've been sort of following this scene since then, and the images that they've been able to generate have been getting better and better. But then there was sort of like one weird thing. The images it generates are, they're not perfectly looking. They're kind of weird, in some sense artsy, but some sense just weird and trippy. And, I would show these images to my friends, and a lot of the time they just like wouldn't really get it. They were just, they'd be like, what is it? It just looks weird. Like they didn't understand it. And so, I thought that there was something really interesting here. Maybe the difference is that like I understood the details and was able to appreciate why it was different. Mm-hmm. But there seemed to be a disconnect. So I sort of wrote the blog with the intention, partly with the intention of like trying to show people like this is super cool. People need to like see how cool this is.
Did it change? Did your friends thought you were doing cool stuff afterwards?
Yeah, I think it worked. they liked it, and I think like a lot of other people found the blog too, and they've said that it's helped them get into the clip art stuff. Anyways, I think it's really cool, and I just wanted to sort of express that with my blog. Yeah, and I've only been blogging for since like this year.
You're so a movie I've star. Been,
I've had a lot of like topics that I've felt like I know a lot about and could just write some stuff on, and so this was one of those. Yeah.
I think your Twitter bio says that you're the head of the blogging for this association in Berkeley called ML at Berkeley.
Yeah, machine learning at Berkeley. It's like a student organization. We do sort of, you know, different research projects with ML industry projects and like a lot of ML education. Like at the school, we teach like a couple of like student talk courses on it and stuff. And we also have this blog, and I was last semester and over the summer running the blog. During the semester, we tried to make a blog post every week, and we basically succeeded. I would edit the post. I didn't write every post. I only wrote a few of them, but you know, other people would write them. I would help them edit them and put them into form. And yeah, we covered like a breadth of topics, stuff in RL, stuff in NLP, multimodal stuff, you know, all kinds of topics, whatever people were wanting to write about, we would, you know, cover.
And like, what like one rule of thumb you have or like trick or heuristic that you found like from editing a bunch of those blogs? Like something people do by mistake and then you correct them.
I would say that like, especially with technical writing, it's really easy to make like assumptions.
Yeah.
Especially like if you're an expert in an area, like people oftentimes, you know, assume things. And, you know, I'm sometimes reading blogs that people write where, you know, I'm not an expert in the thing they're writing about. So like the biggest feedback I'm able to give is like, sometimes is like, you know, this isn't clear to me. So if it's not clear to me, you should probably change the writing a bit. Yeah, and you know, so if I'm more of an expert in the area, I might not be the best opinion for that. But yeah, I think like the most useful thing is like, blogs are, you know, it depends on what audience you're aiming for, but a lot of times they're aimed for a more general audience than a paper. So, you know, if you send it to people who maybe aren't fully experts in the area and they're able to understand it, then that's like a good heuristic for, you know, your blog is at least useful, you know.
Yeah, and sometimes they become references for introduction to some subject instead of having to write the paper. I was working with like a researcher at DeepMind on meta learning, and I was asking for references, and she was like, "Oh yeah, just like check out this Berkeley AI research blog post. This is the best thing you can find on the topic."
Yeah, sometimes the blogs sort of take a life of their own. Like, I think some of like the diagrams in Chris Ola's blogs on RNN have like become like the standard diagrams. Like, if you go to any like university's slides on RNNs, like you'll just find the figure from Chris Ola's blog.
Yeah, why create your own when you have Chris Ola's diagrams? And yeah. Also, like, I think he was recently on a podcast from 80,000 Hours, and he said that he got so many views from his blogs, like, I don't remember if it was like 500,000 or a few million views or something.
Okay.
That, like, in terms of impact, just like changing this one diagram to make it like 1% better would have had a huge influence.
Yeah, the probably would have like hit changing his diagram probably would have like had impacted more people than like a lot of papers even.
yeah, that's another complaint I see from another guy from a Clarity team at OpenAI, Nick Camarota, where he's like super kind of pessimistic and cynic about writing papers, and even like writing distilled papers that are very, very long and very, very hard to write. Probably
a lot of work.
Could have more reach if you just like had a, I don't know, Twitter thread with some likes.
Yeah. Well, people do all of it. Usually there's a paper, a blog post, and a Twitter thread now.
Yeah, of course. So yeah, maybe we can start looking at the art. Hopefully it will be edited so that we can like look at it and it's below us or something. But yeah. The first slide is one from Ryan Moulton, which has been very productive in the past few weeks. I think he's an engineer at Google.
Yeah, he's been doing some.
And he has this series about doorways where there's that one doorway about something, one doorway about something else. And the left is remembered and the left right one is forgotten.
Oh.
But I don't know like the rest of the prompts. So I'm curious how he did it. Anyway, for me, like the forgotten part would be kind of old school art that people do used to do, and it's a bit like of a white peel and black peel, sorry, blue peel and red peel, like the blue peel you're selling on Earth and you still make art with paintings. The red peel, you understand that you can make like crazy art with AI and you find new stuff. So yeah, if we enter this door, hopefully, yeah, we end up in this beautiful place. Sort of painting, you'd be able to create magical spells like wizards, and those wizards say prompts, they say something in words, and there's like some beautiful stuff that happens. If I had no clue about AI art, for me it would be like a painting from Impressionism from 100 years ago, 200 years ago. It's actually made by AI.
Yeah, it kind of gives that feel. It's got, this one has like a lot of emotion to it.
Something like, can I?
Oh, it is invoking something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, those kind of vibes, you know?
Yeah. That's definitely that sort of impressionist.
But anyway, let's go back to the slides. Share. No, not share. Present. And yeah, so if you want to reach our expertise in AI art, that is very much just like sending prompts to some API and or in some notebook and getting awesome results. if you need to travel this long distance to master the AI craft, so you're at the beginning of this journey and at the end there's this mountain of magical powers that you must summon, and you need to understand AI, or at least I would want to understand AI. And for as lucky as we are, we have this. You didn't. I don't think you said it, but you're an undergraduate at Berkeley. Does a lot of ML research on the side.
Yeah, so I'm an undergrad at Berkeley. I do research at a couple labs there. I work on NLP stuff with Dan Klein's lab, and I've been recently doing some RL research with Sergey Levine. Recently, stuff with RL and dialogue, so sort of blending the two fields.
Right. Yeah. So maybe not precisely art, but you know neural networks.
I've spent some time with AI art in the last over the last year, so. I've gathered the tricks of the trade, and
most importantly, you have those like series of blog posts. So the one about alien dreams where you explain the history, and you have a two series blog post on DALL-E explaining why is it so good, and one more on VQVAA.
Yeah, so I have the one about where I sort of go through the history of using Clip for art that's happened in the last year, and then I have a two-part thing on DALL-E. The first part sort of covers VQVAE, which I wrote that one before the DALL-E paper released, and you know the blog sort of described using VQVAE or something very much like it. They use something similar but not exactly the same, and so that blog
DVAE.
Less relevant. The second blog post came out after the paper, and I described DVAE, which is a variation of it.
For me it was still interesting to go through part one to get something even more standard, and then like the kind of amelioration they did.
Yeah.
With the cooking vectors or cookbooking vectors.
Codebook vectors.
Codebook vectors. So let's start. This is an image, because DALL-E was obviously made from WALL-E and DALL-E, so I gave it like this kind of text plus WALL-E and DALL-E to a guided diffusion model, and it just like didn't change that much WALL-E, but only DALL-E was like slightly different. I guess the prompt was like, there's a DALL-E text and Wall-E and DALL-E hanging below something.
Wait, you put them like the both of the images next to each other as the initial image?
I just like, yeah, did next to each other, and I did a 512 by 512,
oh, interesting,
screenshot with like a lot of time steps skipped, so it stays pretty close to the original image.
Yeah.
So yeah, this is, I guess, the the most simple way to see DALL-E.
Yeah. So this is sort of the intentionally. This diagram is sort of the highest level, most black box diagram of what's going on. So
please give me an armchair in the shape of an avocado.
Yeah, so you just ask it for something, and then it outputs an image. So you just use natural language, and you get out an image. So the incredible thing about it is that it's able to sort of get at like very specific things in the text. Like, I doubt there is an armchair in the shape of an avocado, but it's able to combine these two concepts and generate like what looks very realistic.
And I think it's one of the most realistic thing we have for doing that. Since DALL-E, like, they haven't released more things.
Technically, it's not released, so nobody's been able to verify this or like,
well, how there's DALL-E Mini, right?
Yeah, DALL-E Mini, which shows some promise, but you know, we need to see how it scales to this level. Yeah.
Also, you think, are you saying they might have cherry picked their examples, or?
Yeah, I mean, they're probably, I mean, I'm not saying that they don't, that DALL-E is not good. It probably is very good. But like, as for like how good it really is at this scale is, you know, like, I would want to get my hands on it, you know, because sure, the examples probably are cherry picked. If you look at the blog, the prompts are a little bit engineered if you just look at them.
Engineered in what sense?
Yeah, so go to their blog, you'll see what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I've tried some of them. So it's like something in the shape of something.
Yeah, so they have stuff like a few examples. It's like a pentagonal green clock, period, a green clock in the shape of a pentagon. So there's these like redundancies in the text prompt. There's some pretty obvious engineering there. It's like they clearly added the redundancy because it was working. But I'm just saying that, like, you know, I'd want to get my hands on it to see like how good it, you know, and then they haven't released it yet. Yeah.
I've tried DALL-E Mini and I was kind of disappointed by the results. I tried some kind of things and it's worked, like an avocado in the form of brain, a brain in the shape of an avocado.
Oh.
And I got like one brain avocado.
Okay.
Out of 10 times.
Yeah, I think, well, first, like, so DALL-E Mini, I guess it's like the open source version, and mm-hmm. Group of researchers decided to put together, but it's not at the scale that OpenAI did theirs. Their OpenAI's model is like, so I think it's like 14 billion parameters, and DALL-E Mini is like a couple hundred million. As you just scale it up, it should get a lot better. And
right.
Yeah.
One point you made was that the system was trained end to end. What do you mean by that?
Basically it means it was trained to generate images from text. Like, that was the sole goal it was trained for. There's like some subtlety to that statement. So DALL-E, usually when people mean end to end, that means like, you know, in the entire model is trained input to output. So the input in this case would be the text and the output is the image. And it's trained, you know, for that task. The gradients are going from the output to the input. That's like mostly true for DALL-E, except there's sort of this two-stage training thing. So like arguably it's not fully end to end. But I mostly meant in that sense, end to end in the sense that it's trained directly for the task of text to image, which is in contrast for the clip-based stuff, which is not necessarily trained for that. Which I guess we'll get to the clip-based stuff later, but it was more to make a distinction there. Yeah.
I guess you had it later. Few examples. I think most people have seen those, but they're still pretty fun. Yeah. So a baby Daikon reddish and a tutu walking a dog. So it was obviously not in the training set. And then our lovely avocado shares.
Iconic.
Iconic.
I think it just demonstrates like how accurate it is at like matching with the prompt. And I don't know. I found these examples like really inspiring when I first saw them. It's kind of mind blowing.
So yeah, if it was like a kind of data set of a bunch of shares with different shapes, and you kind of match them one together, it would be amazing. But like on top of that, I think those shares never existed. Like some of those shares are so crazy that nobody ever built them.
Yeah, it's designing its own chairs. This is like innovative design right here.
And about the like baby Daikon reddish in a tutu, they
Yeah.
might be pictures of it on the internet because you can find anything on the internet.
I
But
mean, yeah,
there's also
to be
people.
fair, these all have a consistent style. So like probably that like drawn or vector art style is like very much something you would find on the internet.
Sure.
Yeah.
It's more like the illustrative style.
Yeah.
And yeah, I guess those OpenAI ones were impressive as well.
Yeah, it's
Do you
able
want to
to
comment on
draw
that?
the text, or you say OpenAI and then it print or displays the text on there, which is
Yeah,
pretty.
so it's kind of understand that like in front of a store you need to have those yeah, there's like letters printed out, super thick, that
Yeah.
indicate what your store is about. And if it's like more like a company thing, it will be bigger and white. And if it's like a shitty, I don't know, grocery store, it will be like printed like in red on the window.
Yeah, like nailed all the different fonts and stuff.
Oh yeah. It managed to have some consistent font and some font correspond to the business.
Yeah.
And then the one about the cat, I think.
They prompted it with the image on the top. So it's like doing some basically it's so they prompted it with the text and like the top half of the image, and then it had to like copy the image on the top and put it on the bottom. And the interesting thing is that like in the paper they say like we didn't expect this behavior, we just tested it out. And you know, this ability to like sort of style transfer top to bottom is I guess you could call it like some sort of emergent ability of it, or it was able to sort of do that kind of style transfer within the prompt like that. Yeah, it was
Right,
nice.
it's able to understand that it needs to copy the input image and apply the styling of a sketch. It's kind of a style again for the input. Okay, what do we have next? Okay, now ne next we need to kind of go into the boring math and understanding how do you put
How
some
does it work?
beautiful avocado share into discrete codes.
Yeah, how does it work? So I guess on the high level, there's like two parts to DALL-E. There's like one part which converts the image into a sequence of discrete codes, which is like what this is showing. And then there's a corresponding decoder which can take a sequence of discrete codes and turn into an image. That's like one part of DALL-E, is converting images to discrete codes and back. And then
And when you say discrete codes, is an arbitrary length of codes, or
there's basically a set length for like a given size image. So like if the image is, you know, whatever this is, like 512 by 512, there's going to be a certain length of code. I don't remember what the exact number is. It's like maybe
okay.
32 by 32 discrete codes. And the discrete codes are just like a list of integers between 0 and 4000 or something.
Okay.
Yeah, and each of those, that sequence is supposed to represent an image. So you can think of it as maybe akin to like your DNA or even language, you know. Mm-hmm. In your DNA, you've got this sequence of, you know, discrete things. You've got like the four amino acids, and those make up your code. Similar, like this is the DNA for the image. It makes up the code.
And, so and if we can we put this can we go further with this analogy and saying that maybe like number 56 is for green, 73 is for shares, and yes. 67 is like avocado or something. And if you have like those three codes, you have like those avocado shares.
Yeah, it's not gonna be that clean in reality, but like as a good thought experiment, you can sort of think of it like that, as you know, each of these codes represents something about the image. It might not be as, you know, as concrete as like this is the avocado code, but yeah, but that's sort of a way to think about it for sure.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, before we jump into like more of the nifty details of DALL-E, I had like kind of a troll question for you. We wrote this post, why is DALL-E so good? My question is obviously, why is DALL-E so good?
Well, I guess the answer I came to was like, the main thing is just scale. So I mean, there's some clever algorithms, and like it's well formulated
data.
Well formulated, but yeah, scale, data, and parameters. And you know, it's been shown that the transformer model, which DALL-E is sort of based on, scales really well. And so, you know, they're able to just sort of scale it way up, and you get really good capabilities. This is sort of a pattern we see a lot. Like GPT-3 is the same sort of idea.
You kind of also need to have architectures that support these trainings. And
yeah, so the formulation was good. They had this pretty nice DVAE thing to, you know, convert the image to codes. And the reason we want to convert it to codes is because the second part of DALL-E is to basically train a what's effectively a language model, because you can think of these codes as a language. So, you know, the language model learns to, given some text, generate the codes for an image. And these language models work best with discrete things. So, you know, converting the image to a discrete length of codes is sort of a natural thing to do. That's sort of a big innovation with DALL-E, was, you know, formulating it in this sort of image to discrete way.
So yeah, you put this image into some kind of embedding, into this discrete embedding that you can later on use with your like token embeddings that are also in a discrete space.
Yeah. So. Yeah, so once you have this discrete sequence, you can then basically input it into a language model, and the language model just embeds the discrete sequence like it does with, you know, language tokens.
Right. Makes sense. The decoder, I guess, takes this code and how does it know exactly how to generate the image from the code? Is it like a direct mapping from like image to code, or will it produce something pretty similar?
Yeah, so it's more or less a direct mapping to image to code. So technically outputs, given an image, it outputs something like a distribution over codes. Usually people just take the argmax of that distribution, and that's sort of the code for the image. And then the decoder, yes, it's effectively a one-to-one map of code to image. On a very technical level, it does output a distribution of images, but again, almost always people just take the argmax, so it can be seen as just, you know, one code-to-one image, yeah.
Cool. Awesome. So I guess I pretty much understood this one. It's pretty clear. And then there's this a bit more complex, I think it's from the VIE, Variational Autoencoder blog.
Yeah, so this is basically like one of the techniques for turning images into discrete codes and discrete codes back to images. This is called one of the like most popular techniques. It was VQVIE, and like,
which stands for?
It stands for Vector Quantized Variational Autoencoder. So the variational autoencoder is basically a latent variable model, autoencoder model, which is pretty well known. Basically, it converts images into these latent variables, and then the latent variables, there's the encoder, and then the decoder turns the latent variables into images. So VQVAE, instead of using a continuous latent variable like the normal VAE, it uses a discrete one, and it does that with vector quantization, which is where the name comes from. So this is a diagram of like how it works, how the vector
quantization. Right. So and from what I understood, so VAE is autoencoders in general are way of simplifying the kind of representation by compressing into a smaller space. So you get this latent space where you can sample from, often called Z. And variational autoencoders, they do some funny tricks with like Bayesian priors and posteriors and do more stuff about distributions. And I didn't quite remember the code book in the embedding space. What was the code book about?
Yeah, so the code book, so if we have a discrete latent variable, that basically means, you know, the latent isn't like a continuous vector like it is in most VAEs. Instead, it's like a sequence of, you know, discrete integers within some range. And so the code book is basically sort of the key to converting the continuous vectors that are output by a encoder and converting them into discrete codes. So how this is achieved in VQVAE is the image goes through this encoder and it outputs these continuous vectors, or like a grid of continuous vectors. Mm-hmm. And each of those continuous vectors, I should note that the grid is like a compressed version of the image. So it's smaller. There's sort of this bottleneck where it has to, you know, compress it, and, like you said, and then decompress it. Yeah. So then the continuous grid of vectors, it's each vector gets compared to the code book, and the code book vector that's closest to a vector is sort of becomes the discrete code for it. So if it's the, you know, in the code book, if it's like index 10 or something, is the code book vector that matches the output of the encoder, then that vector becomes sort of like 10 in the discrete code.
Can you match with multiple code books, or do you take the one that is the closest to you?
Yeah, you just take, so in VQVA, you just take the one that's closest, and you can have a grid though. So like there could be a bunch of vectors, and each vector sort of goes through this nearness operation. So that gets you a sequence of discrete items.
Cool. Yeah, now it's way more clear. For me, like if I were to have like very simple code book in my head, would be like one for X, one for Y, one for Z, let's say. And then like if the dot product with the one that was encoded was like more on the X side, the dot product would be more with the X. So it would have the like discrete value associated with the like code book for the X axis or something.
Yeah, it's roughly like that. It uses the Euclidean distance. So you have this list of fixed code book vectors, and you just get the Euclidean distance between the encoder output and those. And yeah.
Okay, so it makes a lot of sense. Then you get all those codes, and for decoder, what do you do when you decode from those?
Yeah, so you take that list of codebook vectors and you just input it to this decoder, which is another sort of convnet type thing, and that sort of is trained to reconstruct the image from those codebook vectors. So the whole point here is like, you've compressed it to this discrete space, and you want to decompress it to the original image.
Is it similar to like some kind of a generator from a GAN that needs to like output something that is from the original distribution, or?
I would say that the architecture is probably really similar to a GAN, where you're taking in some like latent thing and turn it into an image. The training technique's a bit different. So in this case, it's an autoencoder, whereas GANs are trained a little bit different than these kinds of autoencoder things. But there's like one little trick that's kind of tricky here is like the argmin is like not differentiable, so they had to like do a weird trick to get that to work. But they just sort of like hack it and like differentiate back through it.
I've seen the argument in your blog post that so what was the act? It was the to make it one or zero or something. Is it the thing where it's one if is the argument or zero otherwise?
You basically just like if it's you basically just like act like that operation didn't exist in the like computation graph sort of. Yeah. Like you just skip that operation and
pass nice the grade nice down. ML trickery.
It's kind of illegal.
Yeah, moving on to the next one. This one I haven't seen yet. So you have a avocado share into your encoder network. Then what happens?
So basically this is a diagram of the DVA, which is like another discrete autoencoder thing, but it's a little bit different than the VQVA. The basic idea is you still have this notion of codebook vectors, but sort of the hacks are a little bit different. So with VQVA, we had sort of this like vector quantizing hack where you like get the nearest vector. Here, the hack is what's called the Gumbel softmax, which is sort of a trick for approximating a discrete distribution with a continuous distribution. Because the problem is you can't really differentiate through sampling from a discrete distribution, so they try to approximate
it. Another trick to make stuff differentiable.
Yes, it's just another hack.
And yeah, if I my inch would be that. So now you have like a probability distribution over your, I think people call that the posterior or something. So you, instead of saying, yes, it's the codebook vector number one, you're more like uncertain about which codebook vector it is. And so this gives you more flexibility.
Yeah. So in the VQVA, like each output mapped to exactly one codebook vector. Here, you're able to output sort of a distribution over them, and so the image comes in, and then you get sort of these distributions over codebook vectors, and then they use this Gumbel trick to sort of approximate sampling from these discrete distributions over the codebook vectors, in a way that's differentiable. Yeah.
Cool. Sounds a bit hacky, but I trust that it works. And those I think are your diagrams. So yeah, you have those four codebook vectors and a bunch of like convex.
It's basically describing the like Gumbel softmax idea, which is like each of these black dots is supposed to represent a codebook vector, and then the idea is with the Gumbel softmax approximation is like instead of, you know, just in a discrete distribution, you would just be sampling at these black dots, right? You can just sample these like four points. But if you sort of continuously relax it, you could sample anywhere in the middle. And Gumbel softmax sort of allows you to tune a parameter which sort of controls the degree to which like the distribution stays close to this discrete thing versus like spills out into the middle. I guess the next slide sort of you can go to the next one, shows how that like kind of intuitively works. Like if this tau parameter in the Gumbel softmax approaches zero, it's like just this discrete distribution, but then as it increases, it becomes more like within this convex hull of the vectors. So by convex hull, it just refers to like the space between the codebook vectors. Yeah.
But like on the I might have missed something, but like if you're at tau equals to zero, and you're doing your, and you're still doing your trick, where you have a distribution over which codebook is closer to you, would it change something? Like do you still be like if you're in the middle, you still have like a fourth, like a fourth of your master probability for each one, right? So what does the like yellow in the middle does?
Yeah, so theoretically you can't really set tau to exactly zero, because then that's when you hit that limit where it's like not differentiable.
Right.
But as long as it's like a little bit greater than zero, you can get something that's close to the original distribution but still differentiable. And yeah, so like as you increase it, it sort of like pulls a little bit of the probability mass away from like the exact points and pulls it a little more in kind of towards the middle a little bit, you know.
Why is that in the right diagram, the yellow point is very yellow, so as of
yeah,
it became a code book vector, or it's like of higher probability?
Yeah, the middle. So if you make tau super big, it's just going to like always, it's like in that limit, it's always just going to sample like the average of the codebook vectors. So that becomes like the highest probability point if tau gets way too big. In practice, you would never want to set tau that big. You probably want to set it like closer to zero, but not exactly zero, so that you're like better approximating the original distribution.
And when you say sampling a code vector, if we go back to maybe this one, when you say sampling a codebook vector, is like finding the codebook vector that is closest to you in Euclidean distance, right?
Yeah. So that was the VQ VAE trick. This one is different in the sense that it's sort of outputting this distribution over codebook vectors. So VQ VAE have like this one or zero, is it closest? Here you sort of take these inner products and get this distribution. And
so the kind of thing in the middle, if it would, the distribution would be like a fourth and a fourth and a fourth for everyone, and then you get the barycenter in the middle.
Yeah, so once you increase tau, basically what happens is like the original distribution sort of gets overwhelmed by it basically just averages the codebook vectors. If you look at the formula, it makes a lot of sense. It's the same thing as a temperature in like a language model, where if you make the temperature really large, you're basically just uniformly sampling from the distribution.
What about this next diagram from your blog?
This one is a lot of numbers. Basically, it's this is just more like a detailed description of like the machinery behind like this Gumbel softmax trick. It's like what you can see is like you have this distribution that output over the latent variables. So you have like 0, 1, 2, 3. Those are the discrete latents, and it outputs these distributions.
Mm-hmm.
And then using the Gumbel softmax, you get sort of this weighted sum of the original codebook vectors that's supposed to represent a sample from that distribution. And so as you can see, it effectively sampled this index 2 the most. So put the most weight there. And it's sort of approximating sampling that discrete item.
And at the end, you can fit. So the resulting vector from that you feed your decoder will reconstruct the avocado share image from like all those like encodings you had, all the discrete encodings.
Yeah, so it'll take sort of the discrete, the vectors corresponding to the discrete entities, and basically pass it to this other like compnet to reproduce the image. Yeah,
that's super interesting. Was it something people did before DALL-E, or
there were some like text image techniques? They weren't good. So like DALL-E is probably the first one that's like noticeably really good at text to image, which is why it was like so groundbreaking, or you know, so surprising to a lot of people.
Having your latent space with like discrete codes.
Oh, like what? So are you asking like what other models use this kind of thing?
Oh, well, like if they were the first ones to use it effectively, or if there were like other models doing it.
So yeah, the discrete thing, it's kind of become like a popular thing recently. DALL-E was not the first one. It was the first one to do DVAE, but VQVAE has been popular for a while. Like Jukebox, OpenAI's like music generating AI that basically relies on a VQVAE plus a transformer. So you know, the VQVAE approach is pretty popular. There's a lot of works recently that I've been using because it works better than like normal variational autoencoders. Yeah, it's just a pretty good technique in general. Yeah.
And then we have this formula that for me is kind of very pretty close to what we have for GANs. Not quite, but so essentially, yeah, could you explain a bit the formula or?
Yeah, so this is the evidence lower bound, or usually pronounced as elbow. Basically, this is the formula that's used to optimize like variational autoencoders, and so these techniques are sort of instantiations, discrete versions of a variational autoencoder, VQVAE and DVAE. This is sort of the loss function for that. Basically, what it does is it reparameterizes. So the initial objective is to maximize the likelihood of, you know, the image, given the latent vector, and so this sort of makes that tractable. Basically, it makes that objective tractable of maximizing the likelihood of the image given the latent vector, and it sort of reparameterizes it with this trick. So you can show there's with some proof you can show that this objective basically upper bounds that. Or lower bounds that likelihood. So this might be the negative version of that, but you know, maximizing this elbow is equivalent. It lower bounds the true likelihood. So if you maximize the elbow, you're also sort of maximizing the likelihood is sort of the idea, and you can show that mathematically. But
Okay, so there's a trick to show that you converge to the right thing, and those are equivalent. But if we just look at the left term, you're sampling from like your latent space distribution, so Z sampled from Q, and you want to so you want to be the probability to be closer to one, so that the expected value is zero.
You want to maximize the likelihood of the image.
Yeah, and so where x is like your input image, so you want to be able to reconstruct it.
So that the last term is like reconstruction.
And then the KL divergence. So what is y in this context?
Okay, yeah, so I think this might be from this might be from DALL-E or something. Yeah, I think this is from the DALL-E. Yeah, so y in this context would be like the text you input to DALL-E. So usually in a normal VAE, there's no y here, it's just P of z. But we're sort of assuming that the y is given, like the text is given as well. But so basically, the intuition for the right term is you have some prior distribution over the latents, and in a sense, this is sort of regularizing the posterior, which is this Q of z given x, sort of pulling it towards the prior, which basically, well, it's probabilistically motivated, but you can sort of intuitively think of it like this. In a normal autoencoder, like if you didn't have this, it could basically place the z's anywhere in like vector space. It could sort of like for a given image, it could put it in its like own far out pocket in the vector space, which is corresponds to like memorization, right? There's not, ideally, we want our latent space to have some generalization to it where, like, you know, if we move from the image of the cat to the dog, there should be something in the middle that's like a blend of the two, right? This is like a desirable property. So when we do this KL divergence, we're sort of pulling the posterior distribution over the latents, pulling it towards sort of, usually it's, you know, the prior is like a Gaussian of like around zero. So you're sort of pulling the latents towards the middle so that they can't sort of spread out like that. that's sort of the best intuition for the right hand term.
I guess I get what you mean. Like for me, the kind of post wrote about VQ VAA, where that it would give you some nice compact Latin space representation, mm-hmm. where you could navigate between concepts, and if you navigate it between like a cat, a knight, a dog or something, you would have like a cat during the night, and it would all like be in some very complex space.
Right, yeah, and I guess like in the discrete autoencoder setting, like you usually assume the latents are uniform, or the prior is like a uniform distribution.
Mm-hmm.
So this KL divergence is like, I guess, pretty simple to compute because, you know, you make this sort of naive assumption about uniform latents.
So you're saying it's, given those assumptions, it's pretty easy to compute those.
Yeah. So the whole point of this like loss function is like it turns something that's like not really tractable to compute into something mm-hmm. that is. Yeah.
Yeah, because the thing that was not tractable was, was p of x or something for a posterior.
Yeah. So the thing that's not tractable is like in the case of DALL-E directly computing the likelihood of images given text. Directly computing that is a bit non-tractable because of like various computation limits with like sequence links and transformers and stuff. Reduce it to this latent space, which sort of makes the problem a lot more computable. Yeah,
got it. But just to finish with DALL-E, like the end goal is still to when I give you a prompt, you send me a distribution over possible images corresponding to this prompt.
Right. So I guess like the brains that are doing that we haven't really gotten to yet. So this is just like take the image, convert it to a discrete code, and discrete code back to image. But the part that does, you know, given the prompt, generate an image or generate the discrete code corresponding to an image is sort of the next or the second part of DALL-E, which is like the transformer part.
Oh yeah, let's jump into transformers. I heard it's like very hype at the moment, so we must jump into the massive transformer. I know what a transformer is. You have this an armature in the shape of an avocado as tokens, and you also have generated image latents at the end. Why is that?
So basically this is like effectively out of the box the same thing as like a language model like GPT-3 or something. So you give it this image and arm care of Chalicado, and you can think of these image latents as like just more text or something like that. It's playing the same role as like language.
Right, it's a code.
So this output probability is just like it's trying to predict what the next token in the sequence is or what the next image latent would be. So that's what it is. It outputs this distribution over what predicting the next image latent, and then, you know, that goes back in as the input and it predicts the next one. This is how DALL-E generates images. You input the text and then this transformer predicts a sequence of discrete latents, and mm-hmm. then you pass that to the decoder to generate the actual image.
So it's not like generating, talking about images, it's mostly talking about latents, and then with like all those like DNAs latent codes it can but like at the end it should like output something like a end of line or like end of text token saying like I'm done.
Yes. Yeah, the transformer is basically operating on the like the DNA of the image, not the image itself. The number of latents it outputs is like fixed for a given image size. I think it might be fixed for all, or it might have only been trained on one image size. I'm not actually super sure, but it just generates like a specific number and then it stops, and that's like the image code.
That was like surprisingly clear. I didn't think it would be this clear, but right. So maybe you're a good explainer.
And the discrete stuff is a bit convoluted, but like on the high level, like, you know, the transformer part, it's like it's just a language model in a where it operates over text and images.
And what about the number of like codes? Do we have an upper bound on this? Like how many different codes can we have?
What do you mean by this specifically?
Like the number, how like many... the our maximum integer you can fit in as a code.
For each item, like what is the range, kind of? I think it's like, I think Dolly might have been like 4096 for each item. So then the total number of images it can generate is like, I don't remember the number of codes. It might have been like 32 by 32, right? So 4096 raised to the 32 times 32 power.
Okay.
It's a large number of images.
Okay. Interesting. So it can still generate a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, so there's a lot of discrete sequences you can input, or you can produce, yeah.
A lot of avocado shares.
Yeah.
And yeah, if you're still with us and you're still not interested in machine learning, there'll be some cool art at the end. But I think this one is the last one. So I think it's essentially the same thing. We have those generated latents from our transformers.
So this is just
Can we explain this?
Yeah, it's basically just showing the decoder. So, you know, the transformer generated these latents and then you feed it to the decoder. So you get the codebook vectors for those latents, feed them to the decoder from the DVAE, and that produces the actual image. Because it's sort of second step after the transformer.
The decoder is essentially like looking into the cookbook and showing like the page in the cookbook and be like, oh yeah, we need to like cook a pasta or something.
Yeah, exactly. The codebook sort of like the sequence of code sort of like tells the general picture, and then the decoder sort of takes that like general idea that's in the code and turns it into an actual, cooks it up into an actual image. Yeah.
How does this like mixing happen? Is it just like an addition, or is there like a some kind of not softmax but like MLP, like a normal layer at the end that combines those?
Yeah, it's basically just like a big conv net that turns the code books into images. It's learned with the DVAE, so it's the part that learns to reconstruct. Yeah.
It's the kind of the discriminate the generator in the GAN somehow.
Yeah, and the generator part of the DVAE.
And I don't know why there's a scaling thing. I think you added this one.
Yeah, I added this. Well, I think like in general, like I guess like the reason Dolly is so good, you asked me this at the beginning, the reason it's so good, like you said, once we got to the transformer, it's like, oh, it's pretty simple. That's the point. It's pretty simple. The reason it works so well is just like you can scale transformers way up and they get better.
For now, the scaling load tells us that. So if you're trying to get precise, from this picture, the loss decreases. Is it?
Yeah. So what this is saying is like this was on language models technically, but it was just
It was from the scaling loss paper from OpenAI.
Yeah. It was basically just showing that like there's you can show that as you scale up language models, like the loss goes down.
I'm just trying to like intuitively grasp the power minus 0.048. But
I'm not sure how to intuitively grasp it.
I guess.
It's basically saying compute go up, language model go brr.
Yeah, because we divide, like at some point we will divide. So the I guess the loss is somehow predictive accuracy.
Yeah, so the loss in the case of language model is like highly predictive of like performance. Not so I guess there may be some weird edge cases where like the loss goes way down and like it's able to generate really poorly, but in general this loss in the case of like DALL-E or a language model is highly correlated with like its ability to generate stuff well. Yeah.
Do you think the scaling law will last for all how long?
That's a big question. Honestly, I'm kind of excited to see. Like we had GPT-3, which was like a surprising thing. I think that like got a lot of people into this idea of scaling laws. And like since then, there haven't been things that have pushed past that much, in a sense. So like I guess I'm excited to see like how the scaling continues. I have a feeling that yeah, like you'll probably go a few more orders of magnitude before it like tops out.
Yeah, we still haven't seen it flinch.
Yeah, we haven't seen.
I think recently there was a paper, I don't remember which company, that did like 176 billion parameters just to compete with OpenAI.
They were basically replicating GPT-3 and they added
Oh
like
yeah, they replicated GPT-3 and then they applied it on other
they
stuff.
added like a couple billion more maybe just for the headline, I don't know.
Yeah.
They changed a couple things, but it was basically the same thing as GPT-3.
And yeah, I guess the scaling laws, they're like a different. So one thing I saw from a scaling law somewhere else, maybe I got it wrong, is that the bigger your model is, the more sample efficient you are.
I mean, you can kind of see that from this curve. It's like the bigger it is, the like the I guess let's see where is it, so like if you see here, like if you throw 10 to the second petaflop days on it, it's I guess maybe it's not as obvious here, but like generally what you see is like it requires less training samples to get like to a lower loss or the same loss
Yeah.
as like a smaller model. So it's like able to sort of eat the data up like more efficiently, absorb it into the parameters better when you have a
Yeah,
large
and
model.
another guest on the podcast, Connor Leahy, he was saying that what surprised him most with GPT-3 is that it has only seen the training data like once. So it's only able to go through like one epoch, and sometimes one epoch is enough to fully get it.
I don't even think they did a full epoch, which is interesting. Like people might say like GPT-3 is overfitting, but like in a technical sense, it really can't overfit because it didn't even see all the data points more than once. Yeah, like it literally saw like each like GPT-3 has a surprising amount of factual knowledge. Some of those facts might have been repeated in the data set, but like it never saw them in the exact same like line of text more than once,
Yeah.
most likely, unless there's repetitions in the data set.
So
But
yeah, that was something that impressed me about scaling laws. And do you okay, so are you part of people who think that like scaling law is ending, that we're not going to get this trend forever, if we're going to get less compute, or
I would say I'm generally pro scaling.
No, there's a difference between being pro scaling and being like optimistic about scaling.
Well, okay, I would say I might not be as optimistic as some people in the sense that like, scaling I don't assign a super high probability to scaling a transformer alone leading to AGI. There might be some people who actually take that claim. Maybe that I wouldn't assign zero probability to that either, but
How much?
I would, yeah, so I think one of Connor's takes is about AGI and GPT-3, right?
I think that's a meme you said to to clickbait the podcasters, but
But I would say that, like, I do think that there's probably like one or two more like innovations we need to figure out before like we hit the real
scale. Where
I'm not sure exactly what it is. I guess, like,
do you think if Sergey Levin were to like build another cool few shot learning from robotics, and a nice, or John Shulman did like an even more general PPO that was like very simple, efficient, we would get it? Or
maybe I'm thinking like so I guess like on the opposing side of the scaling laws, there's this idea of like symbolic AI, or like neurosymbolic ideas. Maybe those ideas are at least like slightly debated, or they're debated right now. I think that that sort of symbolic idea might be kind of important. Like, we might need to imbue some sort of inductive bias for symbolic manipulation to like get better scaling. It seems that there's better generalization with, you know, if you're able to like manipulate discrete symbols, that sort of idea might lead to like better generalization or something. It's a very vague notion, but so sort of my intuition.
Yeah, I guess I get what you came, where you're coming from. I've seen the, like, I think at the end of your posts you talked about like is it like hype? Are we in the middle of like a huge hype on language models and DALL-E and multimodal and stuff? Or is it some very good progress for like understanding of AI? And I think you quoted Gary Marcus and other people. So my guess from reading those paragraphs were that like you were kind of in that camp.
I'm not fully in that camp. So I do find some of the symbolic ideas interesting. I respect Gary Marcus's work, but I'm not exactly sure where I am, but I'm definitely also on the pro scaling side. So what I'll say is, like, you know, I think the scaling laws are very legit, but there might also be like one or two things like before the scaling like really kicks into like high gear, you know. Like right now it might be something like, you know, the scaling works pretty well, but, you know, we might need like one more trick involving some sort of symbolic manipulation before, you know, some like next level scaling, you know.
So I think you define like symbiotic as having some like mapping between physical perception, or like something that exists in the real world, and some societal construct of a meaning. So like a person and like the actual human being moving or something.
Yeah. So
is that roughly correct?
Yeah, I was mostly referencing this pretty interesting DeepMind paper, which describes sort of a unique philosophy on symbolic AI. I think it differs from a lot of other takes on it. And yeah, so they sort of formalize symbols as like, you know, there's some physical substrate, maybe like an image of an elephant, and that corresponds to some abstract symbol. And they describe, you know, the paper goes into it like in great detail and describes it very well, but sort of this idea that you have, like, you can think of it in your head as like this sort of network of these symbols, and basically like their meaning sort of shifts depending on the context, so like the symbol is sort of the abstract thing for the substrate or the image. I guess like that, I think those ideas are really pretty, but and like a good way of thinking about things, but I think like where the power of the symbolic stuff comes from is sort of the ability to like yield some sort of like logical manipulation or things like that.
Yeah, you need to be able to kind of do maybe like addition, subtraction, or object detection, and like manipulate those objects in a sequential manner.
I guess like my strongest intuition is like it's really vague as well. It's like this idea of like finding isomorphisms in like discrete spaces. I think that might be like part of the trick for generalization is being able to find isomorphisms. So seeing like this situation is, sort of maps onto this other thing that I've seen before. You know, I get a feeling that like, you know, these transformers are probably, they're able to do this to a degree, but like if you sort of explicitly somehow encode for this idea of isomorphism, you might get something better. I think that's sort of my current thinking, is like there's something with isomorphism, but it also it's very vague, and like I'm still figuring these things out, but
I guess one isomorphism, or at least like abstraction, would be like all humans are the same thing, are the same concept. And like you should treat them as similar, or like making kind of boxes of symbols between, and or maybe like even in language having the same like words in different language meaning the same thing. I'm trying to find the neurosymbolic AI paper my friends always send me. You know when you have a cube and a ball and a cylinder and you need to ask questions and then you write a programs about those. I think the paper is Neural Symbolic VQA, Disentangling Reasoning from Vision and Language Understanding. And then like, yeah, I think just to for listeners, I think there probably be a link in the description, but what you said about symbolic behavior was a paper by DeepMind called Symbolic Behavior in Artificial Intelligence.
Yeah.
I think.
Yes, it is a great paper.
Great paper. Highly recommended by Charlie Snell.
Yeah.
Now let's go back to, if you don't mind, go back to our magnificent slides on how DALL-E works. I think we passed a few ones.
Yeah,
so we have those convex things, the math, the KL diversions giving us kind of the intuition about how we want our latent space to look like. Transformers generating stuff, then generating things, so decoding, using a decoder to use those like integer codes into images. And here we are. Here we have those. How do I remove this? Here we have those magnificent avocado shares that everybody's been talking about for the past.
We finally got to the
8 months.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Through all of that description, we finally have gotten to the avocado shares, and
this is what it's all about, right? Yeah. This is why we're here.
Yeah, this is the
talk about avocado shares. And now let's go to, wow, nice transition. There's no transition about clip. I wanted to make a transition about clip, but I didn't have time to do so. So clip. I think I finally understood how clip worked.
Yeah.
do you want to explain it, or can I try to explain it? No, you should be better explain it. You're the smart one.
Okay. I mean, the basic idea behind clip is like it takes in a bunch of images paired with their text prompts, or there's a big data set of images and text prompt pairs, and clip basically learns an encoder to encode each image, an image into a vector, and the text into a vector. And its goal is to sort of like make it so that the image and the text corresponding to a given image, those the vectors sort of align. And you want the text prompts that don't match with an image to like disalign. So there's sort of this contrastive loss of like classifying, given an image, classify which text prompt matches with the image.
When you say the vectors disalign, is more like the encoding vectors having a, like being orthogonal and having like a zero dot product.
A negative inner product would be the most disaligned, yeah.
Yeah, negative. Okay, so you can have a...
Yeah, you can have a negative inner product.
Can so, you be like a negative avocado or something?
Or I guess it would be, the opposite. So that is one thing people do in the art thing is they sort of put negative prompts in. Or it's like the opposite of this, yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think from reading OpenAI's paper, I put on the bottom what I understood from the OpenAI blog post, I guess, which made a lot of sense to me, is you give it an image for pre-training, you give it an image, and then you give it like a bunch of random text snippets where there's like one solution.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you're like, oh, please give me the one solution.
Yep.
And at some point, because of massive amount of data and so on, it will be able to give the correct label to the image. But it's not. I guess the difference between like doing labeling with, let's say, traditional RNN labeling, is that you have like a limited set of answers to choose from. So you cannot say like complete garbage. Like you would be at least somehow good, and you would have some reward from doing those. And strangely enough, it learns in the way that correct representations for dogs, cats, and other objects in a very like unsupervised way. This is like the contrastive pretending first part. And the second part is now imagine you want to see if there's a dog or a cat. You can just like feed a photo of a and then you give it two possibilities, cat and dogs, and it would be much easier for him, so it'd be like, oh yeah, it's a dog.
Yeah, basically this sort of allows you to like bootstrap a classifier. You can put in like text for each item you want and it will pick out the one.
For me it's crazy because like I didn't understand Clip as of like 10 hours ago, and now it seems very intuitive to me.
It makes a lot of sense. Yeah, OpenAI's blog is pretty good at describing it.
And I guess if I go back to like the OpenAI blog, I just want to remember like how much images they took.
400.
OpenAI blog Clip, I think it was like the ballpark of hundreds of millions or something.
Yeah, it's like 400 million, I think. It's like a lot. But I guess like when you do all of this data, it learns something useful, but it takes a lot of data. It learns some pretty cool representations for images like you said.
I'm just going to I don't know if I can do this while presenting. I will try to add one that I didn't understand from their blog. Yeah. Which is kind of when they compare their Clip model with ResNet 101.
Yeah.
And they see it has like similar performance on zero shot learning on bananas and fruit and stuff.
Yeah.
And on an adversarial ImageNet, where I guess the images are a bit more strange, like sliced off bananas, it performs way better. So like did you understand what the task was about?
Yeah, so what this is showing is just that like because Clip was trained, in this text objective, it learned something more robust than a traditional image classifier. So like the ResNet 101, it's really good. It was trained on ImageNet, so it's really good at ImageNet, but these other data sets that are like slightly different. So like you know, ImageNet Sketch, it's like way worse that versus like adversarial ImageNet, which is specifically designed to be hard for models trained on ImageNet. It's really, really bad at that. But like Clip, because it was trained on this different objective of like matching images with text, learned something more robust. And so like it's able to perform well on all these different data sets or much better. And you know, that's sort of like a testament to like how powerful of a model it is.
Makes sense. But do you understand the like what's the benchmark? Are they giving them like five bananas and they're trying to see if the labeling from Clip would be banana?
Oh, for Clip, yeah. So they would input an image of a banana, and then they would have, as text prompt, they would have like an image of banana versus, so they're not all, ImageNet is like 1,000 classes or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so it will be like pretty...
Yeah, so it has to pick out the classes. So they used, in these example images, they just picked out the banana images. But in the data sets, there's like 1,000 classes of
different... Yeah, 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 the classic 10,000 ImageNet classes. Okay, cool. Okay, so it's impressive that it performs as well as something like ResNet 101, which is one of the best ones,
yeah,
I guess, from the past few years. Okay, it moves me in the direction that is impressive. Okay, now let's move into the fun stuff, generating art with Clip and understanding what's going on our Twitter timelines.
Yeah, so I guess like based on what we just saw, it's not like obvious how this can be used for art, but with some like clever tricks, like people were able to like figure out how to generate images with Clip. And sort of this diagram, I guess, shows how that's done. So there's Clip has like an image embedder and text embedder, and that sort of then there's like a metric of like how similar the image and text embeddings are. And then you can attach a GAN of some kind to the image embedder and basically do back propagation to the GAN latent. So that you're saying like, okay, we want to pick out an image that is most similar to the text prompt. So in this case, Starry Night, and it will sort of move the GAN latent in a direction so that the GAN generates an image more similar to Starry Night. And then you sort of, you know, that sort of steps the image closer to Starry Night, and then you, you know, repeat that process and like keep stepping. You basically do gradient ascent on the GAN latent. That's sort of what this diagram is showing, is like sort of a high level idea of how you can use Clip to generate art.
So yeah, we're essentially using Clip, so I guess the Clip image embedder is some kind of captioning of images. And yeah, from what we were saying before, it's not really taking something at random. It's literally choosing one prompt between all of the like possible text, right?
Yeah. So the image embedder formally, like what it's doing is it takes in an image and outputs a vector for that image, and so using that vector, you're able to compute the similarity to a given prompt. So the text embedder takes in the text and generates a vector. The image embedder takes in the image and generates a vector. And then given those two vectors, you can compute how similar they are. And
the Clip text embedder is essentially doing like word to vec or like something similar or something specific to Clip.
It's basically a transformer. It takes in the text, it's a transformer sort of like GPT, and it takes like sort of a contextual embedding for the text from that transformer.
Where's the contextual embedding?
So it's just like the last layer of the transformer.
Yeah,
so you just take sort of like one of the tokens, the last token and the last layer of the transformer, and use that to represent the sentence.
So that's like the more technical, let's say, justification. Like, my intuition on when I look at this is more like when I say something like Starry Night or any prompt, it will be converted into kind of the clip's prompt space of like him understanding in English language. And then the GAN is trying to find an image that converted to clip language will be the same.
Yeah, no, that's like basically what it is. Like intuitively, it's like clip like judges the image, and then the GAN sort of like is the space that you're searching for the image that matches the text. Yeah,
and I think one of the first guys to do this was Advadnoun or yeah. Adverb on Twitter.
On Twitter, it's Advadnoun. His real name is Ryan Murdoch.
Oh yeah, and Ryan Murdoch.
Yeah.
And then this create is, I think, beginning of January or February, like a new wave of people plugging GAN into Clip.
Yeah, so right after Clip was, like, the code was released, like, a couple of days later, Ryan Murdoch was, like, figured out that, oh, we can generate images with it, and then he applied big GAN to it and got some really good results after, like, a week of playing with it, and that became known as the Big Sleep, which was, like, sort of the first, like, real, like, clip art generation tool that became really popular.
Wow, it is the next slide. It's just such a coincidence. So I kind of cherry picked two of them that I find interesting, both because of their authors and what they represent. So, I don't quite remember, but I think Big GAN was like the GAN that was known to just be bigger than the others and have a larger batch sizes, so they just call it Big GAN and it worked.
Yeah, it's kind of it's just a big GAN and it can generate like diverse images with like in high quality.
I think from looking at the paper they were just like, oh yeah, we increased the batch size because we can and we're NVIDIA. But anyhow, so the one on the left is AI, which I find quite interesting because you have like robots or a mix of like tech and wires and stuff. And it's from the Lucid Rain repo. Lucid Rain is the guy who reproduces every single transformer-based architecture on the internet.
Yeah. Great work. So. Like, he codes it up within a day of the paper being released.
There's still like some rumors if it's like one only person or like a group of like 20 hackers
secretly 20
doing it full time. That actually is one person. He made the repo for Big Sleep right after Advanoun introduced the technique. And then on the right, there's like this at the end of everything picture. I think you linked it to me, which I found it crazy because since we're not using VQGAN at the time, we're not using any special trick or guided diffusion, and we still have this beautiful thing. So that was like maybe like early February or January.
Yeah, this was around, like maybe late January. Yeah.
Yeah, late January. So yeah, time moves on, but actually those were not that bad. It just became crazy since the VQGAN.
Back then they were even not bad, but like since then it's gotten even crazier. Like I guess as we'll see.
Okay, there's one thing I want you to teach me.
Okay.
What's this Z plus quantize trick?
Okay.
Because when I started using those art things, maybe like between March, April, when it was getting popular on Discord and like Eleuther AI had this bot where you could, or those notebooks where you could like train stuff with VQGAN. I think VQGAN is essentially a GAN that enables to have higher resolutions.
Yeah, it's basically a VQ VAE with like some GAN components, sort of. So it uses sort of discrete latents like we described earlier, and because of that, and a couple other tricks, it like generates really good images.
Okay, so just put VQ VAE everywhere it works.
Yeah.
Plus the clip, I guess, for the iteration loop we saw before between the like having the text embedding the same as the image embedding. Mm-hmm. But what is, do you know what the Z plus quantile thing? Because I think this was on Twitter, on Twitter or Discord for like 1 or 2 months.
Yeah.
And the only thing I remember was that, you know, in the code there was a Z and there was a quantized function. Yeah. But I still don't know what this means.
What it does. Okay, so I guess this goes back to the like fact that VQGAN uses discrete latents. So normally when we're backpropping to the latent vector, like in big GAN, you can just sort of move the latent vector wherever you want. It's like a continuous latent space. But this has a discrete latent space. So basically you can't, like, you can backpropagate to the latent and move it a little bit, but like not every continuous vector is supposed to go into the model. Like you can only have these discrete variables. So the Z plus quantize trick takes the latent that you've that you're learning or whatever and sort of quantizes it to the nearest thing in the code book. So that it can work better with VQGAN. Because if you put anything that's not in the code book into VQGAN, it probably won't work.
So it's essentially a way to put this to put those things inside the codebook cluster that you showed before. Not cluster, but like a trapeze, like a cube.
Yeah, that thing. So the you're talking about the like convex. Yeah, so I guess we're talking about the code. So basically, you can think of the Z quantize trick in simplest terms. What it's doing is like, it's a way to deal with the fact that VQGAN has discrete latents. So it basically normally you can't like backpropagate discrete things like that. Mm-hmm. It's not differentiable. So this trick sort of allows you to use sort of continuous differentiation, but then like convert it into a discrete form afterwards. So it quantizes it to the nearest codebook vector to make the continuous thing discrete. Yeah.
Okay, it's like, okay, so I feel like all those tricks are all about like making discrete things back differentiable.
Yeah. So there's all these tricks, and so this is just another one to deal with the fact that there's a discrete thing, and like use this trick to make it work.
Awesome. And yeah, I think the one behind this, maybe not behind the trick. I think the trick was maybe from Rivers of Wings and Advent Noon.
Yeah.
But using VQGAN plus clip was from Advent Noon.
Yeah.
And so yeah, now we can look at cool pictures.
A series.
This is one of I selected the ones I liked from the one you liked. So hopefully we both liked it. And so do we have comments to make on that? So for me, like, there's a bunch of computers.
Yeah.
And there's kind of an Escher vibe of symmetry.
There's like, it looks like some computers and like, yeah, some sort of like recursive thing in a sense. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I find it's really trippy. Yeah, there are like almost like Escher staircases on the side, actually. You look.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They're like Escher staircase.
I'm not sure where the tubes are. It says a series of tubes. I'm not sure
exactly. So I see tubes on the on blue. In the middle and in the top.
Those blue things, do you think those are the two? Yeah, I guess so. Hmm.
Yeah, I'm not so sure. Or I'm not sure. But I found this was one of the most influential ones from Rivers of Wings.
Yeah, it's a really cool, like,
cool. And this one is amazing as well.
Yeah, this is an Elliot quote.
The yellow smoke that drops its muzzle on the window. What's a muzzle? you don't know as well.
Yeah. Let's check. What's that muzzle? Yeah, this is from a poem by T.S. Eliot, I think. But yeah, I don't know.
So it's, yeah, so for an animal is, okay, in French it's a museau, is just like the nose of an animal.
Okay, interesting.
So the smoke that rubs its nose onto window panes.
Yeah, it's some poetic imagery, I think.
It's pretty poetic, and yeah, just like the colors, having like everything like being blue or gray, and then like having like those clouds, those yellow clouds, it's impressive.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's sort of like dysfunctional to a degree, but like it makes it look sort of dreamy, I guess. Like the image is sort of broken up, but it's got sort of this dreamy feel. Like the window's kind of popping out, and yeah, the smoke. Yeah, it's really cool.
If I recall correctly, you had something to say about why clip generated art was weird.
Yeah. So I guess in my blog, I put it, I said it like, basically the clip generated art is, so with DALL-E, we saw like these really precise images that looked like almost real, like the chair looked like a real chair, right? Like you probably couldn't tell the difference between like if it was an actual picture. Like here we've got sort of these like weird, trippy, abstract things, and like it's not necessarily a bad thing, but it is different. And so I guess the reason you can attribute this is, or one reason you could attribute this to is like DALL-E, like we talked about, was trained end to end. This is not. So Clip wasn't even trained to generate images. The GAN was in a sense, but Clip wasn't trained to generate images from text, right? And so this is sort of how this system works is it's a little bit of a hack. You're like kind of stitching a GAN onto Clip and, you know, forcing images out of Clip. So as a result, you get some like sort of trippy things because it's a little more hacky than something like DALL-E. But you know, to a degree, it's like kind of cool because you're looking, it feels kind of alien. You're sort of looking into like Clip's brain and seeing like how it interprets words. So there's something to appreciate there as well. Yeah. That's sort awesome, of my take on it. Yeah.
Yeah, I've never thought about it. So you're looking into Clip's representation and you're trying to prompt it with, yeah, essentially you're giving some kind of sentence and you're trying to see which image would correspond to this prompt in the like clip space of like image plus text, because like clip is only a space of image plus text, right? Of couples.
So basically you're sort of looking into how Clip interprets the words, like what is the image that most equals this word according to Clip.
Yeah.
One way to think about it is like a machine learning interpretability tool. Like in my blog, I brought up like Chris Ola's deep dream technique, which I think was originally sort of a interpretability tool, but sort of turned into art. This one, I guess, more started as art, but in a similar sense, it can be seen as an interpretability tool. You're sort of looking at like what images Clip sees for a given word. You're sort of interpreting how Clip sees the world. Yeah.
And I guess was Deep Dream, the whole vibe was you're trying to activate to change the image to make certain neurons activate more. And at the end you ended up with like trippy images because those were the ones that activated some neurons more. And it ended up being like very psychedelic with lots of weird colors. Whereas here, it's more like we're trained on like very, so if you add like James Gurney to your prompts, you're trained on like some 3P data from artists. Yeah. And if you use some words like the end of the universe of like psychedelic trip or something,
yeah,
you end up with a mix of all of those,
all that trippy design. Yeah. I guess, like, in a sense, like, I mean, the VQCAN stuff is like stylistically very different from Deep Dream. Like, Deep Dream had like this specific psychedelic look, but like with this, mm-hmm. you can sort of have like all kinds of
style. Yeah, it's very different.
You can mm-hmm. even actually, it's been shown that you can say in the style of Deep Dream and it will do that.
No way.
it knows what Deep Dream is. It's sort of like
yeah, it knows a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. So if we jump to, okay, so this is another one from Rivers of Wings. Yeah. Also from at the time she was using VQGAN plus Clip, which was a few months ago.
Yeah.
Old school art. I like it because it's pretty detailed. I think the one on the right,
yeah, there's a lot
makes of... me think of a famous painter. Is it Kandinsky? No. Painters, Kandowski.
There's a lot of like little details and stuff, and I don't know. I found these ones really cool.
I think I'm thinking about Kandinsky. I think he did something similar. But I'm not so sure. And the details on the left are amazing. Like you're only using VQGAN, yeah, which is kind of a big GAN, but it's not like guided division or anything, and you get like all those details, yeah, just from saying like machinic desire.
Yeah, all the intricate little. It's a big image. There's a lot. I think this one might have been upscaled.
Surely,
like make it high resolution, but.
And okay, now we can move into some of the memes.
The Lacoon cake.
Yeah, it's exactly the Lacoon cake. So I love Lacoon because he's French first. Yeah. First off. So in his original like cake presentation, I think he uses like French words to talk about it.
Yeah.
French Lacoon cake. I think he says so RL, pure RL is the sherry because you do a few bits, you have a few samples. And so you give a few rewards for samples, and then the middle would be like supervised learning, where you get like a bunch of label data. Yeah. It would be like the icing, sorry, on the cake. And the middle of the cake would be cake genoise in French. And that would be like if you have like a large amount of data that is like unlabeled. So mm-hmm. you would do like self-supervised learning.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just wanted to make a joke with...
That's his AGI like diagram, basically.
Yeah. I think his maybe his point is that like RL does not much and will not scale, but and like most of what we get today is because we have lots of data and lot of big neural networks that do stuff. But it's not scalable to like AGI. My point was that the whole like pre-training from hundreds of millions, if I'm not correct, if I'm not wrong, of like text on label was done by OpenAI, of course, mm-hmm. and that's why we have those like this very nice clip representation. VQGAN is like the nice like display features, the latest GAN we can use, So it's like it helps us be like, oh, cool hard.
Yeah.
And then the like the cherry on the cake that differentiates between like awesome artists that like the Rivers of Wings that do like very profound pictures and tweeters are the cherry on the cake. And if you're good at this, then you can build beautiful art.
Yeah. Yeah, the prompting is the cherry, the secret sauce.
It's a little thing that doesn't require much, but it gives all the taste. So yeah, to get a bit on the kind of tricks you mentioned, Unreal Engine. I think this one of the first ones. I think this one got a lot of traction on Twitter because it seems extremely high resolution, where in fact it's not that high resolution.
Yeah, it looks so the Unreal Engine trick is like you put that in your prompt and it makes it look like the video game engine Unreal Engine, I guess, and sort of learns to do that. And yeah, so
this, I guess, Unreal Engine is more like a tool to make video games. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's like a video game tool, video game engine. I mean, I'm no like expert on video game making, but it's some sort of video game engine. And like, I think there's a lot of images on the internet that have like rendered in Unreal Engine, or like, you know, it's a picture of a video game and it says that. So Clip probably learned, you know, if you want your image to look good, but learned like good quality looking images that are associated with Unreal Engine. So if you put that in your prompt, your image will like look more real. Yeah.
I think it's all about like the smoothness and the high resolution.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was one of the most impressive ones.
Really real in this one. Yeah.
Sorry?
The water in this one looks like
insane.
Yeah.
And yeah, if we so that was one of the tricks to unlock the mysteries of the universe, as I say.
Yeah.
You can even combine this Unreal Engine trick with the famous trending on ArtStation.
Yeah.
Which so I think I've never been on ArtStation at all in my life.
I visited it after this stuff blew up. I checked out ArtStation.
It's more like a collection of people's portfolios on pictures.
Yeah, that's what it
seems. Or illustrations.
Yeah, it's like, I think, like an artist website where you can sort of put up your work. And I guess the works that trend look really good.
But yeah, I don't understand how it could like understand the concept of being trending on ArtStation. Like, does it have some like meta tags on the training set that is like, oh,
I mean,
it's trending on.
There were probably a lot of images, like their scraping is probably kind of rough. Like the captions that they have for the images probably had like trending on ArtStation in them. Like, I'm guessing their scrape wasn't like, didn't get a clean caption every time, and it probably includes these like meta bits in the caption, like trending on ArtStation or things like that.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, now I'm thinking more about the licensing issues. If you're just taking all those pictures from ArtStation, are you legally allowed to scrap all those pictures and use them for your model?
That is a very good question. So I do wonder like if somebody, like maybe if it generated an image that looks just like something on ArtStation, could somebody over there like sue Clip? I mean, that's a good question. I don't know.
And, well, like Clip doesn't even generate the images. You should like sue VQ again.
Yes, I guess so.
But yeah, those are kind of publicly available. So if I train a model that, I don't know, use those publicly available images, it doesn't seem that bad. But Cool. Now I know exactly. Okay, they look pretty good. So it makes sense to. Oh yeah. So I'm on a training page. I'm on a training page of ArtStation. It's pretty good. Pretty good designs.
Lots of good. It looks like this kind of.
Can you see it if I put it here?
Yeah. There you go. Yeah, I can see
it now. Oh, very high quality.
And some like 3D figures and stuff. Okay.
Yeah. Cool, but yeah. Well,
oh, wow.
So you can combine Unreal Engine and training on ArtStation, and at the end, so yeah, AK92501 is another big one. I'm not sure if it was the one initiating the movement. I think it was
training on ArtStation a lot. I'm not sure if he originated it. I'm not sure if he originated it or not, but he did. Like his training on ArtStation images became pretty well recognized.
Yeah, paper tweets, DMs are open. Yeah, I think he's one of the like AR artist groups. Yeah, and this one I really like because it's very high definition, and I guess it has the same vibe of training on ArtStation as high quality and a bit darky.
Yeah, the sky is really cool in this one. Like it sort of twists.
And yeah, let's move on to I think this one is from you.
Yeah.
And I copy pasted your prompts, and I made some like colors to see that you also used training on ArtStation.
Yeah.
And yeah, go ahead.
So I used like a bunch. So recently people have been like using more and more like prompt tags, like training on ArtStation. So I used like a few, like matte painting is a good one. So I did like of the streets of busy downtown London on a cold Saturday night. And then in the style of Vincent van Gogh, the clip seems to be very like it generates like a very highly stylized images if you ask for it in the style of Vincent van Gogh. And then, you know, trending on ArtStation and Ultra HD sort of add prompt it for like, you know, give me the high quality stuff. Yeah, and
please Ultra HD 4K.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if you look at the right, like it's very high definition. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I was pretty happy with that.
The Van Gogh, you get the Van Gogh in kind of the lights on the top in the sky.
Yeah. It sort of has a little bit of a Van Gogh twist in some of the colors maybe.
And that's impressive. I've never tried matte painting that much. Do you think that this played like a big role in this?
It might have. I think the matte painting, I think it plays a similar role to like trending on ArtStation. It's sort of like
it probably so you're just adding both.
It sort of like added to it. Yeah, I low key sort of just like
sure.
Spam the prompts and, you know, hope for the best. But there have been some pretty good works where people like sort of ablate the prompts, and you know, you try different combinations of things and do like sort of these extensive analyses of like what this prompt did to the image versus this prompt. And,
those AI artist scientists that do like ablation study.
Yeah, ablation studies on the art. There's some
so on Google, it says that a matte painting is a painted representation of a landscape, set, or distant location that allows filmmakers to create the illusion of an environment that is not present in the filming location.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if matte painting works very well here.
Yeah, because it's a
well, it works. Like it does good results, but
yeah.
Like, it's very counterintuitive.
Yeah. I think one other thing about clip is like, it seems that the order of the words is unimportant. So in a sense, like throwing matte painting in, it might not be like super important, like how it links with the idea of London. It might just sort of add that style to it, you know. There's been like some people who have shown like if you sort of shuffle the words a little bit, like it gives similar results still. Which is
what's your understanding of this? Like if we go back to like the deep learning understanding of it, like did I play the picture, the video? Should I play the video to see how it creates London? I could even like play it at 0.5 speed. So we see
clicking. So this is like the optimizing for the image.
So at the beginning is like it's very red and very city.
Yeah, it starts with a random image and then it sort of turns it into London.
Something more crispy. Yeah, I forgot what was my question. So you try different prompts. And yeah, do you remember what were the ones you used the most? So like ultra, like high definition things, different maybe painters like Van Gogh. Did you try other ones?
Van Gogh, James Gurney.
James. Oh, the famous James Gurney. Yeah, the famous artist we learned in school. Massive respect for James Gurney. I've seen other of his art on Google. It does pretty good art. Yeah, so
it seems Clip has a very good understanding of James Gurney. Like I guess he's a highly online or a painter who has like a pretty good online presence, right? So I guess that helped Clip or something. Like Clip got really good at or associated his style with like sort of this painted look.
I think he also has some like trippy things, a bit like a Dali style paintings with like dinosaurs in the middle of cities.
Oh yeah.
Let me see if I can.
These are nice.
If I can show one here. Can you see something?
Ooh. Yes. Oh, that's pretty.
There's cool. Like dinosaurs. In the middle of seas, a bit like Dali. He used to have Dali, Salvador. He used to have the huge guy. I think so. He has some kind of trippy environments, which makes for like more trippy and inconsistent prompts.
I guess there's sort of these like dreamy fantastical images but also like painted in like a really like high quality paintings as well.
My question was, do you remember like other stuff you tried, like other keywords you use a lot at the moment?
So there's like pencil, like it depends on what you're going for, but like pencil sketch is one I've used sometimes if like that's sort of a style I'm going for.
Do you draw?
No, I guess that's part of the reason I'm into this stuff is like I'm pretty bad at, you know, making the art myself. I've always been bad. Like I have really bad handwriting and stuff. Like I'm bad with, you know, like physically drawing things.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like people like me and you with terrible while drawing can just like say like, oh yeah, a painting of London, like Van Gogh, please.
It's great. Now like the whole world of art has been unlocked.
RIP artists. So yeah, then there's this like other trick I wanted to cover, which is by the pictures are from Advent Noon again.
Mm-hmm.
And you start with like this simple sphere, and
this one might have been AK actually.
AK?
Yeah, the guy AK0, this the sequence number.
Did you mislead me and send me something else? Or was I wrong and didn't copy paste the right thing?
I'm sure it's from AK, yeah.
how much would you bet? This is definitely AK. Because, I guess I confused both of them because they both start with A.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for the correction. I don't know if I can edit stuff directly.
Yeah, it's probably fine for now.
AK 92501. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry, AK. And yeah, so you start with this ball and let's do again 0 points.
Yeah, so this is like image prompting where you're able to put like a sort of a starting image into the thing. It sort of gives it
up. Yeah. How does that work, like, deep learning wise?
So it's like VQGAN, there's an encoder side. So you can take in the starting image and encode it into the latents or whatever. And that becomes like, usually you just randomize the latents as an initial starting point. But if you want to do an initial image, you just encode the image with the encoder and get those latents and use that as your initialization instead of the...
Okay, so you initialize with the encoding of the output image or something?
Yeah, so this image on the left is the initial image. So you'd put that to the encoder, and that would give you a sequence of latents, and you initialize with those latents.
Got it. And interesting. And yeah, you can make this like beautiful earth from...
Yeah, so
and I've seen many people on Discord or Twitter experimenting with like the same exact like 3D model or of a person or of a sphere and seeing like all different styles applied to it.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really interesting in like this like art AI artist science. I want to plug a bit of my merch here because it's something I spent like at least a few hours playing around, and I think the results are pretty cool.
Yeah.
Which is like we combined the things of adding a bunch of different words and prompts with having a start image. And I love Lex Friedman, so the guy on the left is also a podcast about AI. I actually managed to talk to this guy on the right, so Brian Johnson, for his brain computer interface company, and they both have those kind of brain computer interfaces scanning the brains in real time, so you can see the brains and like which part are reacting, and one is trying to make the other laugh, and the fun part about it is when you apply some transfer, so when you try to apply some styles to it, it applies both to the faces of the person and to the brain computer interfaces on top, and you can see the similar styles on the brain scans. And so what I did was I was also like experimenting with emojis. So I was trying to send emojis as well in the prompt, which you can see in the arrow. So like mechanical, I tried to see like everything that could be like a brain computer interface, like a mechanical leg, tada brain, sparkle something. And I started adding, so as you do, I tried to put like photorealistic, sharp, hyper realistic to make sure like, oh please make the thing smooth. And I've also had a vibe with retrofuturism or futuristic, because I think they all look super fun, was like kind of futuristic things but still kind of using tools from the past, and with this kind of vaporwave pink things. So they work pretty well, and my last iterations were adding words from the English language that nobody uses, which is like beauteous or bewitching. Just to see like if adding like nice words would make like the thing more beautiful. If you put it in the prompt, like, please make it gorgeous, would it be gorgeous? And to my surprise, so if you look at the brain scans, the brain scans from the girl on the left is kind of a car. Morph into some kind of very very strange futuristic car. You find some rainbows a bit everywhere. The girl on the left has some pink hair now, which is maybe futuristic, but not symmetrical. But the right, and my guess is that Lex Fridman's face is not very symmetrical. Like he's lying like this.
Yeah.
So it's a bit hard to have symmetry. But for the right image, it is symmetrical.
Yeah.
Somehow, and it's kind of the same expression. And and it has these brain computer interfaces with all the colors and stuff. And the brain scan is an actual brain, but kind of cute. It's like blue and like pink and stuff. So yeah, when I was trying those things, I was kind of amazed at like how you can like start from an image and just like try to modify it whatever you want. Like if your girl Lex Fridman around you, you can just like
transform them. You just add the words and it modifies it. It's pretty.
And even the emojis, like surprisingly, like adding the heart emoji,
it worked.
Made it much more warming and beautiful.
Wow. I've never actually played with the emojis. That's a.
I think it depends on like if you're using Colab or like this Discord Faraday cage on Eleuther AI.
Yeah.
I don't think that the emojis work that well on natural Colabs. There might be something else to do.
Oh, maybe. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. I think now we can move to like state of the art, which is guided diffusion.
Yeah.
I'm just going to see if I didn't have any question I forgot to ask you somewhere, but you can prepare your like explanation of I'm like asking you to explain to me stuff.
Yeah.
Just to finish about DALL-E, you said the transformer in your blog, you said that the transformer part in DALL-E is the meat of it.
Yeah.
Do you still agree with that sentence? That like, most of the work is done by the transformer in DALL-E?
Yeah. So for DALL-E, basically, the transformer is like the brain, like it's the part that's generating the image. Like given the text, it's figuring out what image corresponds to it. And then the DVAE thing is like sort of just rendering the image.
So the transformer is understanding what's going on?
Yeah.
In the language?
Yeah, the transformer is understanding like how the language corresponds with the images, and then the DVA is like just the rendering software that like takes the.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was one. Then. And you also say that nobody knows exactly why transformers work so well. I know you wrote this in like maybe like February when it was starting, but have you felt like in your labs or around you people have more reasons to understand why transformers work so well?
I think maybe there's maybe some progress being made, but I think it's still largely an open question of like, you know, the fundamental reason, like what's so powerful about the transformer. Obviously, like you can sort of make these hand wavy statements about like the attention and the feed forward layers and like all the deep layers, but like, you know, rigorously trying to understand like what is it that makes the transformer so powerful, I think is like still an open question in a lot of ways and like kind of an interesting question to explore. I think a lot of people are working on it, but like Transformers are pretty complicated, so like really understanding them is like not an easy thing either. Hopefully there would be some like cool progress on that soon though.
Soon, yeah. Probably we will have the more Chris Ola working on Transformers for NLP. And yeah, those were be like more for the conclusions. So yeah, let's just like go quickly into the guided diffusion, and then I will ask questions about like your overall takes on deep learning and stuff, and probably wrap it up. So present. Yeah, so guided diffusion, those pictures were just from OpenAI papers. And if you were to tell me that those pictures were not taken by human beings and spot some like mistakes, I would call you a liar.
They look very real. They
Like even zooming in, maybe the tennis ball, like maybe the tennis ball is not what I expect a tennis ball to look like.
the okay, maybe like one of the parts on the tennis ball is like not a perfect curve or something. Arguably.
Yeah, I don't know. I played tennis for a while, so I don't really believe in that.
Okay.
Let's see. Yeah, you need to like really look closely.
The flamingo, like there might be something weird in the background up there.
Oh yeah, it's like a flamingo, but with a weird background. And what is the like gorilla standing on? Like, is it his right arm or a tree?
Yeah, it looks like it's like leaning on a tree branch, maybe. It's kind of hard to tell.
Anyway, let's stop trying to come to beat OpenAI. And
It's pretty hard.
so yeah, my understanding from what you told me before is that you're essentially starting from noise, and so there's two processes. One is like taking an image and converting it into noise, and the reverse process is like taking noise and going back and take an image. So we just have like those like pictures of noise images and algorithms and the model. And yeah, please try your best to like make
I
it
mean,
understandable for a layman person like me.
I mean, what you said is basically like the high level idea is like you start with some random noise, and there's a model that's trained to sort of denoise it, or like in sort of a step-by-step process, remove a little bit of the noise and then remove a little bit more, and repetitively do this until you've removed enough to where you have like a good-looking image. And so you can generate noised images by literally just adding noise to them, and so that's sort of where you get the training data, I guess. So the
And
entire
the
idea is this like denoising process where you like slowly remove noise until you get to an image.
and yeah, how does that look like in practice? If I want to implement this, I have this noise, I can just like do numpy dot random size of my image and just like add this, and keep going forever, and or there probably is something telling me if I'm going in the right direction or not.
Wait, what do you mean by the right direction?
Well, like if I start with random noise and I just keep adding noise, and I'm still like more or less like in the same Gaussian distribution for every pixel, then it's I haven't made much progress.
If you start with an image and you just add some more noise and keep
Oh,
adding
sorry, I was talking about the opposite.
the reverse. Oh, yeah. So if you want to denoise, that's a hard function to learn, right? So that's why you need a neural network. So the neural network's task is to like sort of figure out the function that maps noise back to images. So it learns that from data, basically.
And yeah, how do you So you do you start by learning this this function that goes from image to noise, or the opposite?
No, so the image to noise is like trivial. Like you can just generate that by like taking an image and just like adding noise to it, like you said with NumPy, right?
Right.
So the image to
but
noise.
Then you have some criteria and that you want to reach a certain level of, like, I don't know, mean or standard deviation that
Yeah.
means that you're close to zero.
There's some like constant terms you're supposed to like multiply things by to get the distribution to converge to like a Gaussian distribution in the limit of like
Right.
adding noise over and over. So those are some like technical details, but basically the idea is like you can just generate that part. Like you have some images, you can generate the noisy versions. And then the model's task is, given that data of like generated noisy images, like learn how to denoise it essentially.
And when you learn to denoise it, so you said you train a classifier, so you train a model to see if it's more or less an image instead of just noise, right?
Wait, what do you mean by that?
So, like, in the denoising process,
mm-hmm.
what's the thing that gives you score or the tells you how good you're performing in your denoising?
So there is a notion of like conditional diffusion, in which case like you do have a classifier which tells you, like, maybe you want to generate an image of a dog, right?
Mm-hmm.
It tells you like how close the current image that you're denoising is to an image of a dog, and it can sort
mm-hmm.
of guide the diffusion a little bit towards dog images. And
you do
sort
that
of
for like all the classes. You have like a classifier for all
right.
the classes, and like for each problem, you will have like this problem will be like, oh, go from noise to cat, and you will have a cat classifier helping you, and you will do that for all your classes.
Yeah, So like, if you want to generate a bunch of cat images, you'd have the cat classifier or. You can use like a general image classifier. So like if the classifier is trained to distinguish between all the ImageNet classes, you could use that one, right? So you don't need a separate classifier for each class, but
because like in the on the bottom left diagram, they say that for diffusion models, gradually add Gaussian noise and then reverse.
Mm-hmm.
So is the reverse the same operations, or the reverse is like the thing you're mentioning where you get feedback from a classifier?
So unconditionally it's supposed to like undo the operation, right? So like the feedback thing is if you want to do conditioning, which is, you know, if you want to like ask for an image of a dog. But if you want to just ask for any image, you don't need to use the classifier. And that like denoising process looks like you're trying to learn the inverse of the noising process. So you're learning to like undo the noise that was added. So there's some neural network which takes in the noisy image and outputs like an un-noisy image version of the image.
Right, and this gives like some kind of loss or error that will backpropagate to the like noise denoising function.
Yeah. So the denoising function sort of learns from the data that you've generated from like adding noise. Yeah.
And how do you know if it will convert to the, like an actual cat at the end?
So basically you set it up so that like you do maybe like 1,000 time steps of adding noise, and so the way it's trained is so that like by the 1,000th time step it converges to like the final version. Is just sort of like how it's trained, is like within 1,000 steps it's supposed to converge.
Okay, so like if after 1,000 steps it doesn't converge through to anything, it's still pretty much garbage, you just quit and you say like, oh, it's bad.
Yeah, basically. If by the 1,000th step you don't have a good image, then like you should just start over, I guess.
Interesting. And yeah, I think I kind of got the intuition. So it's able to generate images from noise, but how is it able to be applied to like art?
Yeah, so this is sort of goes back to the thing we were talking about with the image classifier, like sort of guiding it, right? So you could say image mm-hmm. for a cat, and that sort of guides the denoising process. In that same sense, you can use clip to guide it. So you give it a text prompt, and you can use clip in a similar capacity as you could use a classifier to say, like, give me an image of a jellyfish. You just input type in jellyfish, and it sort of guides the diffusion towards jellyfish images or things like that.
Sure. So okay. So if the prompt were like one word, it could guide the denoising process towards a fish. Yeah,
it doesn't just need to be one word. You can put in any words, and the basic idea is like the guiding process involves like computing the gradient of sort of the how much the image matches with the text. So, you know, any text you put in, like, you just want to like basically you're telling it to like guide towards that text, to guide the image towards that text.
Okay. Yeah, I get the generality. I think it's pretty smart to use clip this way, and yeah, I think we'll see in the like next slide is like beautiful images from like Rivers of Wings, where she was already nailing it with clip plus VQGAN, but now with clip guided diffusion,
yeah,
it's next even thing. Better.
Yeah, they look like they look very different from the VQGAN. They're very like smooth, and like they look really high quality.
Yeah, I guess because they're training on ArtStation, I guess.
probably is
the right one. Yeah, mm-hmm. And also from what I understood, it requires more time to do so then.
Yeah,
as well. Like it takes like 10 minutes or half an hour.
Yeah, so the VQ game ones would take like 10 minutes. These ones take like 40 minutes.
Yeah, so yeah. And I think the resolution now is like 512 by 512. The others were like 400 by 400, at least on the Discord server. So yeah, I've only used guided diffusion a couple of times, and it gave me like insane results with like no tuning at all. Those ones are also my favorite. I think those ones were chosen by you.
Yeah.
So we have everything: a made painting, training on ArtStation, and this angel in the sky.
Yeah, the industrial angel. And then
would you buy NFTs for those?
Would I buy NFTs? I've never bought an NFT. But I mean, like, if I were to buy one, this would be a pretty good purchase, I think.
Yeah, like for me, there were a couple of ones about schools that she made, and ones about singularity that I found were quite interesting. The problem is just like gas prices for Ethereum are very high at the moment, so it would probably be like PayPal or something. So yeah, for the singularity cult by James Gurney.
It seems
it's just like really a bunch of people around a singularity or like a light beam.
Yeah, it's like some sci-fi imagery. I guess there's like I guess those are people. Maybe those are robots. I'm not super sure. But yeah, there's some sort of light beam, some kind of like maybe some kind of like a singularity explosion or like ascension or something happening. I don't know. It's really cool looking.
Yeah, they're amazing, and I'm still like impressed as like she gives the tools of her notebooks to everyone, and you can use those tools, but even by using those tools, you don't get those results, right? So you need to kind of tweak the parameters a bit.
Yeah, there's an art to the prompting.
Yeah, it's called It's called prompt engineer on LinkedIn. Yeah. You can, it's a new job.
This is what you're gonna get hired for.
Well, the Fire of the Mind by Ross Tran. This one I haven't seen. I don't know who Ross Tran is.
He's like, he does like anime kind of. I guess it's like sort of like anime styled art or like 3D like animated things. I looked him up.
It seems trippy. Maybe a bit too gore for me, like the one on the right.
Yeah.
The head explodes.
Exploding, yeah. The one on the
left. Oh, those are, you might have seen this. I took some picture of you online.
Yeah.
Just to make a surprise. and try to run a guided diffusion to see how it would look like. Just so everyone knows, the microphone on the left is completely photoshopped. There is no microphone on the left.
Yeah.
I just want to make a joke about podcasting. Yeah, and so I don't know if it helps a lot, but I just like try to describe the picture like, oh, there's a blonde teenager on a couch with a pen and a notebook, hanging microphone next to him by James Gurney.
Yeah,
but it doesn't seem to make much a difference. I feel like I could just like say no prompt at all, and it would do kind of the same because I skipped too many team steps, like 500, which is like the maximum.
Yeah.
So then I tried to like skip less time steps, and I ended up with this like kind of very elegant blonde person, but like with a mic on his hand, maybe on the left, but with still the black glasses. But I think the one on the left looks more like you.
Yeah. Changed my hair on the right. Yeah.
The right one. I kind of added too many mics. I think I added by Photoshop like five or six one. Mics.
Yeah, it looks like I'm at a press conference or something.
And because I forgot to say you were smiling as well. Surrounded by podcast microphones, so you look like somehow like people interviewing you from everywhere, and you're very sad.
It's very dystopian.
Yeah. So yeah, I just like the idea of like taking real pictures and seeing
what's going on. Yeah, like editing them.
Yeah, we're just like, yeah, you just add a random image and you see how it goes. So now, just to conclude, I just want to talk about more like hypothesizing about what's next, because obviously you've been talking about Jeremy Marcus. Is it all hype? Does it really understand what he's doing or not?
Yeah.
About hype, I had this like Edmond de Bellamy painting. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's like something that's told, that's is one of the first Gauguin paintings sold to Christie's like 2 or 3 years ago for like $500,000.
Oh, wow.
And they had like the Gauguin equation on bottom right. And so the fun story is that Bellamy in French means good fellow. So it's like a reference to like Ian Goodfellow who created Gans.
Oh.
And so people would get
piece. Okay.
People would got like very mad on the internet because there was like another guy who like released the weight publicly, but didn't like put the right lessons. So people like kind of might have used the same weights to produce some very similar art. And sold it for like very expensive price. So I guess I'm interested in like what it means for artists in the future. Like for me, like there's like two types of artists. People who just like have no idea what's going on, and then there's like people who like understand what's going on and either are depressed or adapt and try to become like very good at prompting.
Yeah.
And I see like Rivers of Wings, Advat Noon, AK something, or yeah, all of them are very good at what they're doing. And I think we're going to have a differential between like people who are extremely smart, flexible, able to like code, and have a very nice artistic taste that might like reap all the benefits, but then the rest will be just like average.
Yeah, it's interesting because like you're able to just generate images, like one image after another with this. Like there, it's just like an endless stream in a sense. It sort of brings up this question of like, are these images even valuable? And so I guess like part of the value can derive from like creating some new technique, like what Rivers Has Wings does with the diffusion. Like that's a new idea. So now those images have like some novelty to them. But then like for most of the images, like I guess, there's some argument about like the valuableness, like you have to, you know, be clever with the prompting or something like that. I think in Ryan Moulton's blog, the guy who did the panoramic thing you saw at the beginning, he made some interesting points in there about like, you know, maybe there's some value derived from like just opening the fire hose and like, you know, take like one style or one prompt and just like, you know, spam the model with it, get like everything that the model knows about that prompt or that idea, and you know that can be your art form or like your specialty.
Yeah, like he did with his sacred library or his doorways. Is like
you focus on one thing.
Yeah, and he could generate a bunch of those. Most of them wouldn't work, but then he would become an expert in like what the model thinks of like this kind of prompt. And
yeah,
it's a bit like, you know, mastering a new painting tool and seeing what works or not, trying different techniques.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of stuff to be figured out still too. There's it seems like there's still like new tricks people are figuring out, so there's like still a lot of new techniques for people to discover, I think. Like
definitely. Yeah. And on my one next, I was kind of more like questioning possible applications and like limits in the understanding of it. So one recent one was recursion, where Rivers of Wings had two different plots about recursion, where the model kind of understood that if there were like multiple times recursion in a sentence, it should like include the first recursion inside the first image, then recurse again.
Yeah. So,
which seemed like kind of a complex human concept.
Yeah, recursion, like it seems kind of abstract, and it seems like Clip, like if you ask it about recursion, it kind of seems to understand what that means, which is, I think, kind of interesting. Recursion is definitely like a little bit of a deep concept. Mathematical
and also like I don't know like how much you can understand recursion on an abstract level, like like if you have like a sequence of numbers and you have like and you define a sequence by, you know, u of n plus 1 equals u n minus 1 or something, then you have this like abstract formula where you can compute everything. I'm not sure you can compute everything and understand the logic. It's probably things like, oh yeah, recursion means I need to paint more stuff like outside, inside stuff, maybe.
Yeah.
And I think it's the same for the panda. Mm-hmm. You were saying at some point that, like, I think in your intro to Dolly, that the panda was able to see his reflection in the mirror.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what's the difference between learning that when there is a mirror, you need to have the same image in the mirror that's outside of the mirror, because sometimes it's like the good symmetries. The panda looks like this, and then the mirror shows the full face.
Yeah.
Do you think it understands physics, or is like?
I think it's hard to tell. Like, this is like arguably some like weak evidence for understanding some physics, but like I said, like DALL-E's not even released, so like we can't really play with it. Like, if I was able to get my hands on it and try a bunch more prompts, I could like have a better sense for if it knew physics. But like, you're right, like this could just be like some task it learned, like the mirror reflection, you know, is sort of like symmetry. But I guess there is like some element of physics to it. So, I mean,
so at least like the one on the bottom right, where it's like it's in a profile and it sees the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And there's like in the mirror, it has two eyes, but on the profile, it has only one eye and one ear. So it's the second. Bottom. Wait. Starting from the bottom right, it's red on the top. It's like a red circle.
Yeah, it like makes some errors like that. It also did like, one of these. Where is it? Yeah, like the one on the, bottom second to bottom second to left. Like it sort of like changed the size of the bear. It definitely makes some errors. Like, it's far from perfect there.
Yeah, so for me, it's very... Yeah, for me, it's very difficult to answer if it's, like, understanding physics or not, and if it really matters, like, if it does everything we want in the physical world without, like, actually deriving Newton's laws by hand, we really care. So you mentioned also something about drawing...
Like, on the same hand, like, a baby can, like, understand physics intuitively, but it doesn't understand Newton's laws. Like, there's a similar argument there.
Interesting, yeah.
Like, a baby probably, or maybe not a baby, but, like, a 10-year-old knows, like, what a reflection is. It doesn't understand Newton's laws, though.
Isn't there, like, also, like, animals who understand their reflections? Like, cats or dogs?
Yeah,
I don't know exactly which one. You mentioned some stuff about drawing. I think those were cool from Rivers of Wings.
Yeah, clip draw. It's like a model that draws
things.
Strokes. Yeah, it like instead of like generating the image, it generates like a sequence of strokes, sort of given a text prompt. It's like.
Yeah, it's about sequence of text strokes, and I think I went to the actual clip draw paper called. Yeah. Exploring text to drawing synthesis through language image encoders.
Yeah.
And it was less impressive than Rivers of Wings, but I think you still give him, like, go ahead.
I think Rivers had Wings, like, scaled up their stuff from the paper a bunch to get the really cool images.
Okay.
Yeah.
Those are still pretty cool, like a drawing of a cat and you get, like, a cat.
Yeah, it works. A horse eating
eating a cupcake. And yeah, I guess like for the future ones applications, you have those like futuristic.
This entire video was made with Clip.
Yeah, I have no idea how you can make a video with Clip.
This particular video, I honestly have no idea how he did it. It's pretty wild.
It's just like did it just like. Change prompts and like do a few steps then start from the same image again and again.
Yeah, he probably did something like that. Like for the portal, he might have like taken the image, twisted it, and then like optimized it or something like that. And yeah, like switched the prompts. It could be something like that. But I mean, there's still a lot of details here that seem hard to get right. Like it's relatively smooth between the frames. That seems like a pretty challenging thing to do with Clip.
Also, like he mentions ImageNet 16K, which seems...
That's the, I think
higher
that's
resolution.
The Rugan model.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I was trained on that data. So.
And our last video is also something you sent me, I guess.
Yeah, another video. I thought this one's really trippy.
Yeah, this one is way...
The second half of it, it like turns into a... goes underwater and then turns into like a coral reef and like swims through the reef.
Well, and then there's like some funny
It's so trippy.
dancer.
It's so trippy. It like zooms in into the water.
Yeah, and so I think the difference with this one is it says it uses After Effects and zoom distortion. I don't know how, so I could understand, like, I know how After Effects work to make your work a bit better, more polished and stuff, or for the animation part. But I still don't understand how you would create those form clips. Like, you would have a,
Yeah, I think this is like some combination of like, interpolating between prompts and then also doing this thing where you like generate an image and then you like shift it up and then like generate it, fine-tune the generation. So that's how you get the movement, I think. But I think there's
what do you
probably
mean by
also a lot of
fine-tuning the, so sorry, interpolating the prompts? Do you mean the text prompts or
the
or
text
the
prompt.
image
So like it
prompts?
probably went from like the sea to like an underwater reef, so you have to like sort of switch the prompt smoothly between those two. Like you just change the weight between the prompts. That's one thing you can do is you can like
Oh,
weight
okay,
the
I
prompt.
think. I don't know if you've seen this as another industry is from, I think it's called Pixel Art, the collab. I need to try to find it. Pixel Draw. I probably linked it into the description, but you can generate like basically any pixel art from anything. And my prompt was two teenagers talking around a table with a microphone for a podcast. Very original prompt. And I don't think, I think you can see like two microphones, I'm not sure. And we're kind of in a
It sort of makes
tavern
sense.
with
It
a
looks like
hoodie.
a tavern. Yeah, there's definitely a green heady.
Like two adventures in a podcast or something. So yeah, for me the main things are video games, cinematography, and real engine things, drawings, and yeah, understanding, like, if we want to build general AGI, can we build those? Just to wrap it up, yeah, questions I like to ask are, is there a good question I should have asked you but didn't? This is a meta question.
I mean, we kind of covered a lot of stuff. A good question, I guess. What is my favorite piece of art?
What's your favorite piece of art?
I like the summer day ones from the beginning.
Yeah, I think the summer days are the better ones. Yeah, they're crazy. Like, they're so, I think if I could put it in my wall, I would. Yeah, do you think there is too much hype between like Clip, Dolly, or GPT-3? Or do you think that the hype is deserved?
I think that I think the hype for a lot of the stuff is deserved. There may be like a little bit too much hype on like GPT-3 in its current form, but and maybe DALL-E too, mostly because like we haven't gotten to see what it actually is capable of. But I think that they
Are you like a skeptic with things like because they haven't released it, we
Yeah, dude,
it
I
may be
want them to
crap.
release it. Like, I'm not commenting on the model till they need to release it. But I think that like still like clip I feel like is a little bit underrated, or like the clip art stuff, or underappreciated. Like, there's still like a lot of people who don't quite get like how cool it is, I feel like. For GPT-3, I think it's like a little bit overhyped in the sense that like from the outside perspective, like, it's easy to have this assumption that you're dealing with this like very intelligent thing, And then, you know, if you actually play with it, it's like very capable, very impressive. But like, sort of this notion that like GPT-3 can do anything is not exactly true. It has some limitations. Like once you start to play with it, you can kind of get a hold of like what its limitations actually are. It kind of struggles with some reasoning tasks, but it's also surprisingly good at some.
So about like recent news, were you impressed by Codex? Because I think some of your tweets were about Codex.
Yeah, I think I'm generally pretty impressed with it. Like, I was surprised playing with it. I've been pretty surprised. It was able to code. So it wrote some code that took me like several minutes to read and understand. like it was able
was
to
it like ML code or software engineering code?
Like algorithm code. Like I gave it some leak code problems. Now there is a question of like it may have seen the leak code problems in its data set.
Yeah.
So then possibly memorized, but I was still pretty impressed with that. And like, basically just like using it on, like to build, like they have this good JavaScript interface. So I was able to like build a, like a simple spreadsheet app by just talking to it, which was pretty cool. Yeah. So I would say I've been pretty surprised with, or pretty like impressed with Codex. Like, it like makes mistakes from time to time, but like it did more than like I was initially expecting. So,
yeah. And yeah, you've used Copilot as well.
I haven't used Copilot.
You've just used Codex.
Yeah, I've used Codex. I didn't get access to Copilot.
Okay, I didn't get access to Codex, but I did get access to Copilot.
Yeah. It doesn't make sense. It happens.
Well, I guess it depends on when you subscribe. I think for Copilot, I asked like the same exact day.
Yeah.
How much would you say it increased your productivity from using Codex?
Well, I haven't gotten to use it in an IDE, so it's not the same as Copilot. For Codex, I've only used it like to play around with it. I haven't actually coded with it yet.
If you were to like have it on your ID, what do you expect would be your gains?
I think it would be helpful. Just like have it type out stuff, but I'm not sure what the like exact like quantitative
number
productivity gain would be. Like, you've played with Copilot? Has your productivity gone up?
So I think it went increasingly up the more I played with it. So okay. In the beginning I was very bad at prompting it.
Okay.
A bit like prompting art, you're just like suck at it.
Yeah.
But then when you understand that like to get what you want, imagine you want the result of a back prop. And I was doing this like manual back prop and I forgot to say it was a back prop, so the moment I add the comment hashtag backward,
oh,
it generated like correctly the rest.
Oh.
Or sometimes I think most of the time is it comes from the having wrong prompts.
Yeah.
And not being able to use it correctly. And also because I give feedback to Copilot, it's like a bit like using the Google search engine a lot.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of learns to adapt to your coding style.
Oh,
interesting. So I would say that like me, without having used it a lot, I would be like 5% more productive. Now I'm more like in the ballpark of like 10 to 20% more productive.
Oh, interesting. Do you expect that to continue to increase or?
And I expect that to increase, of course, with future models. Essentially you just like start thinking about something, you type the first thing of your code, it knows you, it knows what you're doing, it just like create the entire function and just like, oh yeah, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if you have no idea how to do something, you're like, oh yeah, I want to create a crypto trading bot. So you say like, oh yeah, crypto trading bot in your doc string. Generates a bunch of function and then you spend some time reading about like, oh, those are useful calls for like the CoinDesk
API and so on.
Yeah.
So it's more like a Googling. It can be like a Googling research. It can be like an autocomplete of you.
It replaces Stack Overflow kind of.
Yeah. It takes everything on Stack Overflow and picks up what's more relevant to you and like replaces the variables so it works with your code.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think we're going to see like a massive shift. So basically, you know, like back in the days, people would like not use Stack Overflow and saying like, oh, not use Wikipedia and be like, oh yeah, it's full of scams. I only read manuals from, you know, the Linux manual and paper or the manual from C.
Yeah.
now like everyone uses Stack Overflows because that's convenient and you can just copy paste code that works.
Yeah.
And I think we're having the same paradigm shift where people are like, no, my company won't allow me to do that. This is stupid code from average programmers on the internet. But yes, soon enough, most people will use it. And if you don't use it, you'll be left behind.
Yeah, so to keep up with the productivity requirements, you're going to need to use these tools.
Yeah. Or you just like enjoy having your friends autocomplete a bunch of code.
Yeah.
All the time. And you're just like, oh yeah, how do you type this? last question, what do you think of Tesla bots, Tesla humanoid bots?
I think it's cool that Tesla is like getting into robotics research. I think that's really cool because OpenAI like canceled their robotics research program, right? So like I think from like a
They canceled their research program on AI?
Yeah, OpenAI closed their robotics
program. Oh, OpenAI, okay.
Yeah. So I guess like from the research perspective, I think it's good to like have more players on robotics, and like Tesla's going to go down that road. I think that's really cool.
But what about robotics with like humanoids?
Like, yeah, I mean, like, I think it seems like right now there's like a lot of work to be done, but like he had the person in the costume and the dancing around on the stage. I think it's like a cool idea and I would like to see them succeed. But I think it's also like a really hard problem. Like I think a lot of roboticists have been working on this for years, and so I mean Tesla has a lot of resources, so they can probably do something cool, but it's definitely gonna be hard.
Yeah, I think their argument is like we are a car company, we have all those elements to do it, we can do it.
Yeah.
It will make it boring task easier. Any message you want to pass for the like podcast listeners to like your socials or your website or stuff you wrote, you're proud of?
Well, I guess I would say like if you want to learn more about the stuff we talked about, you can check out my blogs. And also,
what's the name of your blog?
Well, my blogs are just on the machine learning at Berkeley blog. So the clip one is called Alien Dreams and Emerging Art Scene. And the DALL-E ones are sort of like under the title, like DALL-E Explained. So there's part one and part two.
Part one, which is VQVA Explain, and part two, yeah, which is why is it so good?
Yes, those are the two parts. and then you can also follow me on Twitter. I'm like reasonably active on Twitter. That's sort of my main social media.
What's your Twitter handle?
Yeah, I'm at C Snell. So it's sort of a pun because my name is Charlie Snell, which starts with a C, but it's not the letter C. It's the word C, like S-E-A. So S-E-A underscore Snell.
Nice. It's a good mnemonic. Thanks for being so calm to explain all those nifty details. It shows that you have a good understanding of all of this. And hopefully see you later on the next episodes if it's boils down to it.
Yeah, I mean it was good talking to you. So this is fun.